Robbie, what's on your radar?
Well, the American Medical Association is the paramount advocate, lobbyist, and trade association for doctors and medical professionals. Its influence in the healthcare industry cannot be overstated. Recently, the AMA released a report, co-written with the Association of American Medical College's Center for Health Justice, titled Advancing Health Equity, A Guide to Language, Narrative, and Concepts. The report contained all sorts of advice for how to make healthcare more equitable. But it mostly focuses that advice on language, what words and phrases doctors use to communicate ideas. And sadly, the people who worked on this report were clearly captured by the same kind of social justice progressive activists who have infected academia with woke jargon. The guidance ranges from bad to actively harmful. Take a look at this. Avoid use of adjectives such as vulnerable and high risk. Avoid dehumanizing language. Use person-first language instead. Remember that there are many types of subpopulations and avoid saying target, tackle, combat, or other terms with violent connotations when referring to people, groups, or communities. Avoid unintentional blaming. Now, of course, medical professionals should avoid unintentional blaming, but what's the benefit of avoiding words like tackle and target? Should we no longer tackle obesity or target infections? What's dehumanizing about terms like vulnerable or high risk? The benefit of these words is that they've been around a long time and we know what they mean. That's the point of language, to clearly communicate ideas. We want terminology that people understand, not the terminology that is maximally politically correct and inoffensive. And in fact, most of the AMA's new preferred terminology is longer. You're not supposed to say homeless, you're supposed to say people experiencing homelessness. You're not supposed to say disabled, you're supposed to say person experiencing disability, and so on. Now that may sound a little bit nicer, but the major problem facing a whole lot of underprivileged medical patients out there isn't that their doctors are insufficiently nice, it's that their doctors only spend about 5 minutes on each patient. Patients would be ill-served by doctors using longer phrases when shorter ones would do. There isn't that much extra time. Furthermore, some of the new woke terminology is inaccurate. The report wants doctors to stop using the term minority and instead say marginalized. But not all people who are part of a minority are marginalized, and some people who are marginalized are not part of a minority. They want the word vulnerable replaced with the word oppressed, but same deal, not all people with a health vulnerability are facing or have faced oppression. Last week, CDC Director Rochelle Walensky inadvertently demonstrated how silly some of this new language would be when she made the following statement. Quote, "We know that vaccination helps to decrease community transmission and protect those who are most vulnerable." Now imagine if she had said most oppressed instead. As The Atlantic's Connor Friedersdorf explained in his article about it, that would make absolutely no sense. Men are more vulnerable to COVID-19 than women, but not because men are more oppressed. My grandmother is far more vulnerable to the disease than a wrongfully incarcerated teenager, yet she is far less oppressed. That's sort of an important difference. And it calls to mind something that the late comedian and social critic George Carlin noticed about how soft language can obscure the truth. Listen.
I don't like words that hide the truth. I don't like words that conceal reality. I don't like euphemisms or euphemistic language. And American English is loaded with euphemisms because Americans have a lot of trouble dealing with reality. Americans have trouble facing the truth. So they invent a kind of a soft language to protect themselves from it. And it gets worse with every generation. For some reason, it just keeps getting worse. I'll give you an example of that. There's a condition in combat. Most people know about it. It's when a fighting person's nervous system has been stressed to its absolute peak and maximum, can't take any more input. The nervous system has either snapped or is about to snap. In the First World War, that condition was called shell shock. Simple, honest, direct language. Two syllables, shell shock. Almost sounds like the guns themselves. That was 70 years ago. Then a whole generation went by, and the Second World War came along, and the very same combat condition was called battle fatigue. Four syllables now. Takes a little longer to say. Doesn't seem to hurt as much. Fatigue is a nicer word than shock. Shell shock. Battle fatigue.
Now, to be clear, while the report spends a great deal of time recommending ridiculous word substitutions, it also makes grand and, frankly, somewhat Marxist attacks on concepts like individuality and meritocracy. Now, certainly we can have philosophical debates about these things, but is it really wise for doctors to instill in their patients the idea that their health is structural rather than individual? We need to empower individuals, not structures, to improve their health. So this is a rather bizarre line. And in fact, the report avoids criticizing one of the most important structures standing in the way of health equity, which is the American Medical Association itself. As the liberal writer Matthew Iglesias explained in a Substack post criticizing the report, there are all sorts of ways that the American Medical Association, in its role as a licensing organization, works to prevent a better health system from emerging. He uses this chart, which shows that the U.S. has far fewer doctors per person than other countries. Iglesias writes that a reason behind this is that the AMA is engaged in the practices of, quote, blocking increased scope of practice for nurses, making it hard for foreign-trained doctors to practice in the United States, and historically pushing to train too few doctors here at home. He continues, quote, it's a trade association, and unfortunately, this is what trade associations do. Similarly, the economists Tyler Cowen and Alex Tabarrok write that if the AMA really wants to do something for health equity, they should stop trying to police language and instead support nurse practitioners, midwives, physician assistants, and other healthcare professionals who want to expand their practices, lobby for more physicians, and an end to the absurd residency bottleneck and support greater hospital competition. Physician, heal thyself. And the thing about tinkering with language is it can always get worse. I'll give Carlin the last word on this.
Then we had the war in Korea, 1950. Madison Avenue was riding high by that time. And the very same combat condition was called operational exhaustion. Hey, we're up to 8 syllables now. And the humanity has been squeezed completely out of the phrase. It's totally sterile now. Operational exhaustion. Sounds like something that might happen to your car. Then, of course, came the war in Vietnam, which has only been over for about 16 or 17 years. And thanks to the lies and deceit surrounding that war, I guess it's no surprise that the very same condition was called post-traumatic stress disorder. Still 8 syllables, but we've added a hyphen. And the pain is completely buried under jargon.
So, you know, Ryan, I've covered so much, you know, woke language kind of stuff in academia that I'm a little bit jaded by it. And when I saw people like Matthew Iglesias, Connor Friedersdorf were weighing in on this, I actually opened this document, this report, thinking, how bad can this actually be? Because I've seen so many insane examples. And I'm reading it. This actually is pretty bad. Just page after page of recommendations to every terminology for something to make it longer, to make it more confusing to people who have a short interaction with their doctor anyway. And that's the main problem they have. And you know, I don't know how seriously internally an organization like the American Medical Association takes this, but frankly, I hope they don't take it very seriously, because it's not good advice.
So, and this is a case of a tragically and fatally real disparity at work that elites are trying to address with language, and I think one reason they're trying to address it with language is to escape staring Medusa in the face here. And the Medusa is that racism, implicit bias, is producing in our medical system massive racial disparities. Like, and you can study these. Like, these are not controversial. Like, people, you know, a black person goes in for with heart disease, they're going to get different treatment than a white person that goes in for heart disease. A black woman goes in with to give birth, she's going to get a different kind of treatment. Serena Williams famously nearly died because the doctors was like, played off of this trope that black people are just inherently stronger. This is a racist trope that's been around and has roots in slavery and is still with us today. And so, and doctors and medical professionals have this bias. And so they're fine. Serena Williams is fine. And she almost died as a result of this racism. Black patients who have heart disease less likely to get different surgeries that are necessary, more likely to just be given old medicine. And you see the results on the other end. You see the disparity in the results. And in order to change that, you could do a couple of different things. You know, when in the Affordable Care Act, because so many hospitals were being sloppy about sterilization, there were a ton of infections and reinfections and readmittances as a result of these infections, and a lot of people dying. And so they connected the hospital's pay structure to how many readmittances they had over reinfections. and reinfections went way down. This is something where if you pay a price for it, you can do better. And so if you made hospitals and medical systems pay a price for these disparities, you might force doctors, nurses, and others to say, wait, is there some implicit bias that I have right now that is influencing the treatment that I'm recommending here? Let me step back. Also, if you could push and help and get out of the way of black medical students who are trying to get into the system, into the industry, then that could do something too to alleviate some of this implicit bias. Because if you have an all-white doctor corps, they're probably going to have more bias, and then you're also less likely to have for the white doctors to have an opportunity to see a black doctor work with black patients and say, oh, wait, that's better. That's better than I've been doing. And so there is a massive disparity here. It's a massive problem. But our answer can't be just a training about here's how you talk differently as you're giving people poorer treatment.
Right. Yeah. Right. And we haven't given better treatment. Like, over the same time period, the language gets more and more and more sensitive and precise and not going to hurt anyone's feelings. Has the care improved?
Right.
Has the care improved for anyone, frankly? Right. I don't think so. Medical care, like, there have not been great innovations in medical care. It's pretty much like just as substandard as it was, right, for everyone, especially for the marginalized, right, but for everyone as it was, at the beginning of my lifetime.
Right. The treatment of shell shock was just whiskey and gin. and now at least they're looking towards ecstasy.
That's so, right. Opioids.
Yes.
Yeah. No.
That's actually a really good point. The World War II generation, and Mad Men being the good example of this, that those veterans just like hammered all day long,
right,
suppressing,
right,
their operational exhaustion.
Right.
And opioids.
But now we fixed it because now we're letting them suppress their post-traumatic stress disorder, right, instead of their operational exhaustion.
Right. There you go.
Yeah. Well, I'm looking forward to your radar coming up next.